So hello everyone. I hope you've been enjoying the day as much as I have been. I think it's just been spectacular. I'd like to begin by thanking the fabulous musicians and singers from the Conservatory Lab School. Thanks to President Faust for her kind words and for all the support she's shown me and this school. Thanks as well to all of our faculty, our students, and especially our incredibly hardworking staff for making today possible. Thanks to all of you for coming, and a special thanks and welcome, finally, to the former Ed School Deans in the audience for working so hard at making this the incomparable school it is today. We have with us Pat Graham, Jerry Murphy, and Kathy McCartney. I have to say it's a little daunting to be sandwiched in between those phenomenal musicians, Drew Faust on the one hand and Yo-Yo Ma on the other. In fact, ever since Marco's introduction this morning, all day I've thought, well, that's a tough act to follow, and that's a tough act to follow. It didn't help that my daughter, Phoebe, who was here in the audience, she's 8 years old, she told me this morning, could you please be quick because I really want to listen to Yo-Yo Ma. Well, I'm here to talk relatively briefly anyway about the Harvard Graduate School of Education and our campaign, and to make the case to you why I believe this is the right place and the right time to actually begin to change the world through education. But since I'm still relatively new, I thought it only fair to begin by telling you why I'm here. I appreciate that it may not be all that obvious to some of you. After all, I was trained as a lawyer, and I worked as a law professor at UVA for 15 years before coming here. I am, I must confess, a lifelong Yankees fan. I attended a university in New Haven that my Harvard contract actually forbids me to name. I can't say my path led straight from my childhood home in New Jersey to HGSE, so how did I end up here? I'm here for the same reason many of you are. Education changed my life. This story may be familiar to some of you because you've heard it, for which I apologize. For others, I expect it will sound familiar because you have a similar story. Indeed, most of us here today, I expect, have a story about how education changed our lives because that's what education does, at least when done right. My story is this. I grew up in a blue-collar suburb in New Jersey. Neither of my parents attended college, but they valued education above all else. At my local high school, several teachers encouraged me, challenged me, and took an interest in my future. With the help of generous financial aid and remarkable sacrifices by my parents, I was able to attend that nameless university in New Haven. And then I was lucky again to attend UVA Law School on a full scholarship. The education I was fortunate enough to receive opened doors for me that I didn't even know existed when I was a kid. And although it felt like a string of lucky breaks at the time, when I look back, I realize it wasn't luck. It was my sheer brilliance. I am kidding. Those who know me know I have to be kidding. It wasn't luck or brilliance that opened doors for me, but the dedication, generosity, and commitment of others. Our public and higher education systems, in short, worked for me, and I began wondering in college and then again in law school why they were failing so many others. I ended up as a law professor studying, writing, and teaching about the way law shapes and structures educational opportunity, trying to identify and understand the sources of educational inequities, that are both ubiquitous and profound. But because my interest in education has never been solely academic, but also deeply personal, when President Faust took a chance on me, I saw it as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to go beyond simply understanding the problem. To me, being at the Harvard Ed School means being able to do something about it, and that's why I'm here. When I arrived, I was greeted by a lot of questions, as you might expect. I was asked early and often about my vision. I'm grateful to report it's 20/20, thanks to some corrective surgery a few years ago. I was also asked more specifically about where this school would go, what would change, what would stay the same. And answering these questions occupied a good deal of my time last year and ultimately helped frame both our strategic goals and our campaign priorities, as I'll get to momentarily. But to answer questions about what we would do and where we would go, I asked the people who are the lifeblood of this community, our faculty, students, staff, alumni, friends, and partners. As a first step, I wanted to know, are there any core beliefs that hold this community together? At first, it wasn't clear because, as I quickly discovered, we are a remarkably diverse community. Our faculty use different research methods and come from different disciplines and fields. Many come from the world of practice and policy. Our master's and doctoral students hail from states across the country and from countries across the world. Before they arrived, they were themselves not only teachers, but also principals, designers, doctors, guidance counselors, entrepreneurs, and founders of charter and independent schools. After they depart, these same students go on to hold positions across the world as varied as the human experience. They collectively fill every imaginable post in education, from pre-K teachers to the dean of Harvard Law School and the president of Morehouse College. They are alumni. Our alumni are scholars, practitioners, and policymakers. But they are also novelists, journalists, executives, legislators, and edtech entrepreneurs. Despite this diversity in outlook, as I probed a little deeper, I also discovered that there are indeed some common beliefs that hold us together. And I want to share them with you because while it's important what we do, it's also important for you to know why we do it. After talking with hundreds of you in person and by email, I'm certain of this. This community believes that every child deserves a high-quality education and that this is a basic and universal human right. It is what each generation... This is what each generation owes to the ones that follow. Regardless of where a child is born, who his parents are, the color of her skin, whether he can hear or she can see, or whether he sleeps in a castle or she sleeps in a shelter, that child deserves a high-quality education. All of us are here because we believe that education is the issue of our time. It's not only, as often said, the civil rights issue of our time. It's also the national security issue of our time. It is the economic prosperity issue of our time. It's an issue fundamental to our identity as a country that has prided itself and has for centuries on the often unfulfilled promise of social mobility. If we are to make strides in reducing inequality and in increasing opportunity in this country and around the world, we must improve education. We have no other choice. There is no other way. In addition to sharing core beliefs, we all share a common goal, which is to move the world closer to the point when the right to a high-quality education is also an everyday reality. All of us are dedicated to changing the world through education and changing the world of education by expanding opportunities and improving outcomes. And when I say all of us, I do mean all of us, faculty, students, and staff alike. I have never been in a community that has such widely shared, that has such a widely shared and deeply felt sense of mission. We may not have facilities that are as spacious as our sister schools, although we are working on it, as you can tell from the construction behind us. We also don't have resources that are as abundant as some of our sister schools. But we nonetheless have something invaluable, a mission that is critical to all of our futures. Now, I should hasten to add that more resources would not be incompatible with our mission. This is a launch. Unfortunately, the last several words I've spoken are hard to fit on a banner, and I was asked if I could perhaps distill these sentiments into a motto or tagline in light of our upcoming campaign. At first, I resisted because this seemed a little gimmicky. And then someone said, oh, gimmicky, really? Well, how do you feel about Veritas, which, of course, is Harvard's motto? Because of someone who asked me that question was Drew Faust, I changed my mind about mottos. No, I'm kidding. Actually, the more I thought about it, the more I thought it would be a useful exercise to try to express very concisely our core beliefs and aspirations. Well, it turns out this is harder to do than you might think, because mottos, when meaningful, are really about an institution's fundamental identity, like Veritas, or one of my other favorites, Lux et Veritas. Just seeing if you're paying attention. All right. From about December through June, we tried out a number of different ideas that we thought captured the spirit of this place and were also just a little bit feisty. Embrace disruption was one. But as I sat at dinner with my wife, Katie, and our four, well, exuberant children, I realized that disruption is not always to be embraced. And my guess is that many teachers would agree. We never stop was another, which was uniquely effective in uniting my colleagues. They all hated it. Other ideas were tossed out before they saw the light of the day, like this very accurate description. We have both qualitative and quantitative methodologists who work across a range of interesting and important intellectual disciplines. Or the briefer but tad aggressive, who says we're the problem? Or for the directionally challenged, stop by, we're right around the corner from Burdick's chocolate shop. When we finally hit on learn to change the world, it was a genuine eureka moment, because that simple five-word phrase goes a long way to conveying our central beliefs and our hopes. First, our belief that learning and education are the only sure path to changing the world. Second, our hope that HGSE be the place where anyone can come to learn to change the world through education. And third, that HGSE also be the place where you can come to learn to change the world of education by expanding opportunities and improving outcomes. A rare triple entendre that fits on a banner and on a tote bag. Yet it's one thing, even if difficult, to distill and communicate your core beliefs and aspirations. It's quite another to be true to them. Changing the world is obviously not a small task, and there are significant challenges. Graduation rates in many of our largest cities hover at around 50%. The achievement gap remains a persistent problem, even in high-performing states like Massachusetts. Too many kids are behind before they even begin kindergarten, and too few kids attend and graduate from college. Too many schools are isolated by race, ethnicity, and socioeconomic status, and it remains a sad reality that a child's zip code often dictates the educational opportunities available to her. Notwithstanding the magnitude of these challenges, both the lawyer and the dean in me would like to make the case to you that this is the right place and the right time to meet them. HGSE is the right place because we have, over the course of nearly a century, prepared students for careers that have collectively touched and transformed the lives of millions of students. We have generated ideas and research that have altered the landscape of learning and teaching, and we have helped reform for the better, both practice and policy. To be sure, there is much work left to be done in education, and perhaps because of this, I've heard some say that education schools are part of the problem, not part of the solution. And some reflexively assume that HGSE must fit that general description. In my experience, and I'm sorry to be blunt here, those who share that opinion usually have little idea what we've done and almost no idea of what we are doing. They also miss the fact that while there is a good deal wrong in education, there is also a good deal right about it. In classrooms across the country every day, teachers and principals, often underpaid and underappreciated, are transforming lives. And here's the point I want to stress. This school has always been, and it always will be, a big part of what is right about education. Consider some examples from across the years. Drew mentioned some of these. Jean Chao's research decades ago changed how we teach children to read and influenced millions of students and teachers. Howard Gardner and his theory of multiple intelligences revolutionized the way we think of the human mind and changed the way we think of ourselves and our children. Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot pioneered new research methods that helped us bridge art and science and allowed us to see schools with new eyes. A world-class group of experts on human development have found their home here over the years, from Lawrence Kohlberg and Bob Levine to Paul Harris and Kurt Fischer, Bob Keegan, Bob Selman, and Catherine Snow. True giants in their respective fields, these scholars have deepened our understanding of both children and the adults who teach them. And the work continues apace. Rick Weisbord and Stephanie Jones are now pioneering ways to help children not only excel academically, but also ethically and morally. Bridget Terry Long's research has helped simplify the financial aid process to enable more students to attend and afford college, while Jimmy Kim's work has strengthened summer reading programs to prevent students from falling behind while out of school. Andrew Ho is leading the research team at Harvard that is studying how students learn in online courses, while Karen Mapp has created a framework for school and family partnerships that has been adopted by the United States Department of Education. The list could go on and on. As every faculty member here has left an indelible mark on the field, from the most senior faculty to our lecturers and senior lecturers, to the entire cohort of our truly incomparable junior faculty. We are a small school, but our reach has always exceeded our grasp. And if you are not already completely convinced of that, let me cite just one more example. One of the best educators in the world, of all time, Big Bird, took flight here. I know what some of you are thinking, and yes, I know, Big Bird technically can't fly, but stick with me. In the late 1960s, as some of you know, Professor Jerry Lesser, after whom a faculty chair is now named, helped create and develop Sesame Street, the most popular children's educational show in history, which now reaches over 100 million viewers in over 100 countries. That's what I mean when I say our reach exceeds our grasp. We also have a tradition of innovation. As Drew mentioned, we were the first professional school at Harvard to admit women and the first school at Harvard to appoint a woman as dean of the faculty. Hello again, Pat Graham. We invented the EdD degree and then 90 years later invented a doctorate in education leadership like no other in the country. Our alumni, like Jeffrey Canada and Deborah Beal, have been pioneers in programs and organizations that have not only changed lives but saved them. We lead the nation in our professional education programs and were the first to create a National Center for Principals. We've been offering online courses for more than a decade, and our very first edX course drew more than 70,000 students. Our faculty are also actively involved in the field and always have been. Project Zero for almost five decades has been working with teachers and schools around the world. Tom Kane and his colleagues at the Center for Education Policy Research are working with school districts and states from Massachusetts and California to help them effectively use data to improve student achievement. Jack Shonkoff Center for the Developing Child is working with host sites across the country to test interventions that will increase the chances that disadvantaged young children will thrive. Other faculty are working in places from Colombia and Pakistan to Botswana and Kenya to improve school attendance and school environments. Closer to home, our students and faculty are working hand in hand with local schools in Boston and Cambridge. And right here on campus, over 100 education leaders and innovators meet regularly for breakfast and to share best practices. In short, we have never rested and we never will, which is why you can see I kind of like the we never stop motto, but I recognize I just need to let that one go. So I hope I've convinced you that HGSE is the right place. I want to come back to this though at the very end. For now though, I want to explain why I think this is also the right time. We are witnessing a unique confluence of need, opportunity, and interest. I described the need earlier. In terms of the opportunity, we have tools available to us that were unavailable to any generation before, whose potential has not yet been realized or even fully understood. Advances in neuroscience, for example, are offering insights into how and under what conditions students might learn best and thrive, and in the process, generating new ideas that might someday enable all students to reach their potential. Learning technologies offer unrivaled opportunities if used skillfully to individualize instruction and to bring world-class expertise to every classroom. We also have access to enormous amounts of data and greater ability to mine that data for discoveries about how students learn and how to improve teaching. Together, these advances and discoveries could fundamentally change the very nature of learning and teaching. Our children may finally be the last generation whose classrooms still look like the ones our parents remember from their childhoods. At the same time, there's unprecedented attention being paid to education. From President Obama's call for universal pre-K, to education conferences around the world, to countless news articles and documentaries about issues ranging from the Common Core standards to charter schools, rising college costs, and our relative performance among nations. There's a groundswell of interest and a sense of urgency around the globe. And here at home, more and more faculty and graduate students, regardless of their academic discipline or school, are focusing on education. And Harvard undergraduates are clamoring to learn more, both through research projects and through courses like our own KMRSS Dilemmas of Equity and Excellence in American K-12 Education, where over 350 undergraduates recently vied for 60 slots in the class. In short, this is education's moment, and I believe we are poised to take full advantage. We are diverse in outlook and approach, dedicated not to a particular ideology or party platform, but instead dedicated to discovering, implementing, and sharing what works. It's that simple. Our campaign is also quite simple. I spent a good portion of last year, with the great help of my colleagues, putting together a statement of our mission and priorities. It's organized around three strategies: cultivating leaders and innovators, collaborating on questions that matter, and communicating with the field. Together, these three strategic priorities, what I've come to call our three C's, are the way we hope to leverage what we do here on campus in order to make a genuine difference in the world. If we can cultivate leaders and innovators, for every student we graduate, we can influence the lives of thousands of others, whether that graduate works as a teacher, principal, policymaker, scholar, or entrepreneur. If our faculty can collaborate and focus their collective attention on the most important questions in education, We will be able to bring to bear all of the expertise needed not simply to analyze problems, but to solve them. And if we can communicate effectively with the field, we will ensure by listening that our research remains relevant and ensure that by reaching out, that the knowledge we generate is converted into action. We've already begun to implement this agenda, and every one of our campaign priorities relates to these three strategic priorities. Indeed, they are one and the same. We're seeking funding that will strengthen our ability to cultivate leaders and innovators, collaborate on questions that matter, and communicate with the field. To be more specific for just a brief moment, if we are successful in this campaign, the resources we raise will ensure that we continue to attract and support the most talented students and faculty in the world. This, in turn, will help advance each of our strategic priorities for the simple reason that faculty and students are at the heart of all that we do. And it's for this reason that financial aid for master's and doctoral students and funding for faculty hiring and research are at the very top of our campaign priorities. But that's not all. We're also seeking resources to ensure that we have both the ability and the flexibility to pursue programs and initiatives that will further our priorities, including a project called Usable Knowledge, launched 2 weeks ago, that will help us share our research with those who can use it. The Harvard Teacher Fellows Program, that will prepare Harvard undergraduates to be middle and high school teachers. A Scaling Up Project, that will help entrepreneurs get their good ideas to scale. A Dean's Venture Fund that will provide seed funding to collaborative research projects. And finally, a wide-scale project that will enable us to create online programming for new and aspiring educators and leaders, both here and abroad. Suffice it to say that our needs are as great as our ambitions, and that meeting the former will enable us to realize the latter. Now, I am tempted to go into much more, maybe even minute detail, given the inspiration of the story Drew told about the endless dinner. But like you, and I know like Phoebe, I'm eager to hear Yo-Yo Ma. You can also read more about our campaign priorities in our campaign statement that our booklets are on the table in the back as you leave. Rather than go into more detail, I think at this particular moment, while I'm fortunate, hopefully, to still have your attention, I think the details matter less than this question. If not us, who? If you believe that education in this country and abroad needs improvement, perhaps dramatic improvement, who else is in a better position to make that happen? What other institution or organization has the range, the reach, the access to world-class talent, and the independence needed to make a real difference? Who else is located in the finest research university in the world with leaders like President Drew Faust, Provost Alan Garber, and my fellow deans, all of whom, I can tell you, are as passionate about education as we are? And who else has all of you? You are alumni and friends who have traveled great distances to be with us today. You are students who have brought us your passion, your commitment, and your creativity. And you are faculty and staff who have dedicated your careers, your intellects, and your hearts to this place because all of you believe in the power of education and are committed to making sure that others benefit, just as all of you have. I honestly believe that we're at a turning point in the history of education, and our goal is to bend that history toward greater opportunities and outcomes for all. We aim to be the place people think of first when they want honest answers and bold ideas, when they want to know how to solve real problems, when they want to know the very best way to reach and therefore teach students, and when they want to know how to prepare children to be lifelong learners ready to adapt to a quickly changing world with confidence. I am completely convinced that we can become the place that people think of first, that we can become the very brightest beacon in the sometimes foggy world of education. The last question I have for you is whether you'd like to be a part of all of this, whether you would like to help us as we begin the next chapter in the life of an education school like no other. I hope the answer is yes, because we need your help, and we need it fast. As a wise person once said, the future is impatient. Together, but only together, we can help shape that future and learn to change the world. Thank you.